Good evening, everyone. Can everyone hear me okay? So welcome to this lovely book launch event tonight. We are so happy to have everyone joining us. I'm Kristen. I will be behind the scenes this evening. If you have any comments throughout the presentation, please feel free to type them in the chat. I've also shared the online program for this event, which is in the chat box if you'd like to follow along with the program. Just a reminder to everyone that this presentation is recorded, including the chat box that is also recorded. If you are having any sort of technical issue or if Zoom is not loading properly, it could be your internet connection. So please close out of Zoom and close out any other open web browsers that you may have. So with that, let's get started. And I am so happy to introduce Cynthia Vranis Olson, who is the director of the Mies Society, to start us off this evening.
Thank you, Kristen. Travel is to the architect what books are to the scholar. I first heard these words from our professor emeritus, Kevin Harrington, before traveling to Europe with the College of Architecture's study abroad program. Tonight, you will view how Jung Sung Kim has combined the two and through the lens of a photographer. Robert Vischer, mid-century, 19th century German philosopher, has brought us to better understand empathy on issues of art and architecture and how we experience them. In viewing tonight's images, it is as if we are inhabiting a built environment. We simulate the forms and materials in our bodies. In a sense, we empathize with them physically and emotionally. We later come to have a conscious awareness of them. And I'd say in this case, our awareness is of pleasure. But some of the effects that will have to do with Professor Kim's techniques in capturing the essence of a building is with his photography. At this moment, I'm pleased to introduce that this program is a joint venture between the Mies Society and the College of Architecture. And I want to thank our advancement team for all of their support, and to our IIT bookstore for where you can obtain a copy of this wonderful book. Ed Pollack is Executive Vice President of Draper & Kramer. He's a College of Architecture alum and the Vice Chair of our Mies Society Board. Please welcome Ed Pollack.
Good evening, everybody. It's great to be here and it's great to see so many of you have joined us. This evening is almost becoming a prototypical event of the Mies Society and the College of Architecture. We've had a previous number of book launches. This year in particular has been really exciting. You know, in February we had the Lily Reich and Mies van der Rohe program, which was really spectacular. Last month we enjoyed the Mies van der Rohe birthday party, which also featured a number of very interesting explorations of long span structures that I think, again, was very enlightening. And I expect tonight to be more of the same. We've all known Professor Kim for most of our lives and think the world of him. And I can tell you his previous book in this series, which was basically about German and Belgian Romanesque architecture, is one of the first photo essay books I've seen where I could tell by looking at it was photographed by an architect. He photographs not just the building, but the spaces. And I think that architects are uniquely attuned to that perception that he is able to convey through the lens. So I'm very excited about this new book. I'm looking forward to seeing it. And then finally, just to close, you know, I think in addition to these wonderful events of a more intellectual and scholarly nature, the Mies van der Rohe Society is also primarily focused on the restoration, maintenance, and promotion of the Mies campus at IIT. And we've had a great deal of success thus far in raising funds to restore the South Porch of Crown Hall. And I know there'll be more reports on that eventually in the next months, but everything's going great. I really am looking forward to tonight's program and I'm happy to be here with Cynthia.
Thank you, Ed, and for all that you do. Dean of our College of Architecture, Reid Kroloff, is the John and Jeannie Rowe Dowd Chair, has been an editor and a dean of Cranbrook Academy and Tulane University. We greatly value our strong relationship with him and know that the College of Architecture is indeed in very good hands. So it's my honor to introduce Reid Kroloff.
Thank you, Cynthia. And thank you to all of you who are here with us this evening. Ed, I appreciate it. And to the entire Mies Society. We've had a wonderful year, as Ed pointed out, under the direction of Steve Weiss as head of the Mies Society this year, with building a very, very close relationship between the Mies Society and the college that's enabled us to do that series of events that you heard described leading up to tonight. We have also been fortunate that this is our second outing with Professor Kim, who launched a book on Romanesque architecture in Crown Hall about a year and a half ago, a pre-COVID book. And so now we're getting to experience him, his teaching in three ways: one through the book, one as a lecturer in person, and now as a Zoom star. So we're delighted to be able to watch that evolution and to share the scholarship. And I think Ed really made a very important point here, to share the vision, the architect's vision of how the world is organized. You heard Professor Kim is a graduate of our program at both the undergraduate and graduate levels, and a veteran of the school from when it was under the direction of Mies van der Rohe, and is himself a very important architect. And as a product of the modern era, I think that his view of the world, his encompassing view of architecture, should be one more nail in that rotting old coffin that says modernists abjure the past in favor of some indistinct future or present. He's very much, Professor Kim is very much rooted in the past, and I think has an appreciation of it, both as a builder and as an artist and as an observer, that could only have come from his experience as a modernist architect. And so it's a great pleasure to have him with us again. We're looking forward to chapter three in 18 months from now, whatever that is. And I welcome you, all of you, and also Professor Kim.
Well, thank you, Reid, for your wonderful introduction. So I'm making my debut as a Zoom star today.
Yes, that's right.
I will start my here we go. So it was January of 2020 that I had the privilege and honor of presenting my first book on Germany and Belgium in Crown Hall with wine and cheese. But then in the intervening 15 months, things have changed. So we are on Zoom, but then paradoxically, that way more people from outside of Chicago can also watch. And this is the book that I'm going to talk about briefly. And as you can see, it is on Spain and Portugal. I show covers of three books. One on the left, An Introduction to Modern Architecture, J.M. Richards' book. That brought me to IIT. I bought a copy of this in Seoul as I entered the Seoul University as a freshman. And I found this English book in the back alley of a foreign language bookstore. And I'm showing this book not to talk about my sort of a link to IIT, but then during the period of mid-1950s, most of these Pelikan books were just done with the black and white photographs only. As I got the paper-bound edition of Pelican History series, even that did not have any color picture. During the 1960s, mid-1960s, Pevsner's Opus Magnum, that came out in a Jubilee edition with the eye-popping color pictures. I made my first visit to Europe in my third year as an assistant professor. And I visited a lot of Gothic cathedrals that Alfred Caldwell, talked about at length. So I show two images of Amiens, especially look at the one on the right. I am looking straight up at the corner pier and the vaulting of the crossing, how all the ribs are arranged in a logical, visually, absolutely logical, forgetting about whether that's the how that's how the gravity reacts, but then look at how the ribs are clustered into corner pillar and the nave view, how the clustered piers appear to be sort of prompting you to move forward toward the altar. I show on the right, western facade of Amiens, which must be about a half a century later than the nave. But then in the intervening half a century, all these ornaments crept in. So what so impressed me with the nave, its supreme logic, was partially diluted by all these a little too much ornamentation. I show on the left Spire Cathedral, which I included in my first book. And here, the contrast between Gothic and the Romanesque, and partially explains why I value Romanesque architecture. So on my first trip, incidentally with Takeuchi, we drove together, we shared the driving, and we not only went to all the important Gothic cathedrals, Notre Dame Paris, Chartres, Amiens, as I have shown, a few others, but we also went all the way down to Burgundy to visit Vézelay. So that was my sort of a first introduction to one of the great Romanesque masterpieces. So now I go into my book. In dealing with the Iberian Peninsula, I made a conscious decision to include pre-Romanesque. In other words, these a few works of architecture cannot be described as a Romanesque, but then Mozarabic architecture and the one Asturias architecture, because I am dealing with the Iberian Peninsula, leaving them out would make the book a little deficient. So I am showing two images of San Miguel de Escalada, which is about a half hour drive from León. And I want to point out what is called horseshoe arch. That is the sort of a defining characteristic of a Mozarabic architecture. Mozarabic is defined as Christian builders and artisans who stayed generations under Muslim rule, but retained their faith in Christianity. But then as heir to the environment and the civilization under which they grew up, they were inevitably influenced by Muslim language. And here we see one of the very good example. Let me just go through just a little more. Tiny windows at the clerestory, they are filled in with alabaster. That's how it is inside. And other than the few clerestory, the interior is very dim. Second Mozarabic work, this is 9th century. And until recently, it was thought to be 200 years earlier than that, 7th century, but then archaeological investigation has proven that, this was beginning of 9th century. And view on the left shows what we know as a nave was not really defined clearly, but it looks as though it is a series of smaller compound compartments joined together slowly and slowly toward the chancel. Here on the right slide, I want to show the skill of the Mozarabic carvers. This is a story, sacrifice of Isaac. See how, although it may be only about probably 3/4 inch deep chiseling, how impressive and how evocative of that carving. This is a late 12th century, but then on the Iberian Peninsula, the builders and the artisans who participate, even up until the 12th century, look at the dome, how the Arabic dome was placed inside this octagonal tiny Santo Sepulcro church. It is near Pamplona, and this is for the benefit of the pilgrims who just crossed into Iberian Peninsula after crossing the Pyrenees for several weeks. And then this lantern served as a lamp post, guiding post for the pilgrims. And how ingeniously the Arabic rib for the dome is made. I come to one Asturias architecture, and this was built by under the edict of King Ramiro I, who moved the capital of Asturias to present-day Oviedo. And Asturias existed for only 2 centuries, from early 8th century to early 9th century. But then during those 2 centuries, Galicia, present region of Galicia, was within Asturias' boundary. And that during that 2 centuries, the tomb of Jacob or James was found under a star in the field, Campus Stellae. And here, this was dedicated in 842, meaning only 27 years after Charlemagne's chapel in Aachen. But then the builder, the master builder of Santa Maria del Naranjo probably did not have the benefit or the knowledge of what was happening in the Frankish kingdom. That was, I think, the physical barrier of Pyrenees Mountain probably kept most of the builders of the ninth century, rather unaware of what is happening in the Frankish kingdom. But then, nevertheless, look at how ingeniously the builder and his workmen created this house of worship. Then we go into a set of nine Romanesque. I start with this very humble, look at tiny blocks of stone. This is in the Valley of Boy, and it appears, it is reasonable to surmise, it was remote from one of the Roman settlements. If they were nearer, they would have recycled Roman column. But then the builders built the column and the arch from scratch, basically. And then at the apse on the east, they had a stone bolting, and there was a fresco by an unknown master, simply known as a master of Taur. And the fresco was so highly regarded that the Spanish government had the fresco removed, the layer of fresco gypsum was removed, and the original is exhibited at the National Museum of Catalan Art in Barcelona, and the church in Taur has a canvas replica of Christ Pantocrator. But as contrasted to the interior, how humble and amateurish, the campanile on the outside is very, very elegant and refined. And I'm just offering my guess, and I may be challenged by historians among the audience, but then I think this was done by a totally different workshop, probably brought in from Lombardy. This is a quintessential Lombardian campanile. Now I move to Navarre region, and this is in mountain called Leire. There's a short, little bit of gentle mountain range called Leire, and there's a monastery of San Salvador. And we are looking at the chancel and the tunnel vaulting of Romanesque style. And we are beginning to see mature Gothic ribbing of the main nave, which was done about half a century later. Here, the slide on the left shows its crypt and how the crypt is supported by a capital, which does not have the proportion of a classical Roman capital, but slightly more squared, and the ornamentation carved on it has no resemblance to one of the Roman orders. But then the builders were leveling the site for the nave because it is slightly sloping site, and there was no burial in the crypt. But then the nave crypt itself is serves as a place of worship, because the altar sits behind on the rows of columns in the crypt. I come to a mainstream Romanesque on the Iberian Peninsula. This is a royal collegiate basilica of San Isidoro in León. And I want to point out the transept arch facing south transept. And I believe not anybody, even the master builder, not because even the archbishop or bishop asked them to, but then builders almost subconsciously produced a Muslim-inspired polylobed arch. This is inevitable, you know, if these workmen, although they kept their faith, generations in their family, if they grew up and trained during Muslim rule, they think somehow doing polylobed arch may have come without thinking. So that's the point I want to make. Then at the León, we already see, you know, these highly skilled sculptors doing story of Bible for teaching the populace. From León, I go back about 100 years. It is slightly north of Barcelona, in the province of Barcelona, a little town named Cardona. And it is placed inside the castle of Cardona, and therefore there is no faithful who come to a weekly worship. It is again a collegiate church of Saint Vicence. And the nameless master builder and his workshop. The proportion is a little fat. There is a fat man, there is a thin man, and this is a little fat, but then the total harmony is amazing. It's a huge sort of a pier of very geometrical, very, how do I say, almost modernist sensibility, how they all come together in a seamless unity. It is even further, so it's the beginning of 10th century, up on the mountain of a fishing village called El Port de la Selva, again in Catalonia, there is this partially demolished monastery church of Sant Pere de Rodes, and the Spanish government restored it partially, but then they did not make a point of bringing in newer stone to fill the missing pieces, but then left them as a ruin. And simply, I suppose, kept it from leaking and then continuing to ruin. This is a slightly later than Sant Pere de Rodes, and this is called Sant Pere de Galligants in Girona city itself. And from the late 19th century, this is used as a National Museum of Catalan Art in Girona. And it is a sort of a poetic justice, because this is one of the best Catalan Romanesque architecture. And the Spanish government found it worthy of preserving it. And I think it is listed as a national, their national treasure, and they keep it in an immaculate condition. Here on the left, I want to point out the eastern apse, this sort of, this is a familiar shape, but then the campanile, while it is serving as a literally clinging the bell for the faithful to come to worship, it served as a defense function, because they were always being raided by Vandals. So this is a peculiar east end of a Romanesque church. I take you to the top of Pirine Mountains, a neighboring town to the city-state of Andorra. There is a town named La Seu d'Urgel. And in that tiny town, I suppose the population may be only about 20,000 today. But then the bishop and the master builder, which was unidentified, built such an elegant, I'm sorry, the master builder in this case is in fact very well known, I'll show you. And the master builder did a very elegant, well-proportioned church. And I show the crossing. The crossing turned out to be a rectangle, not square. And the builders, under the direction of master builder, made the oval dome. And then of course there is a tower above and a tunnel vault without transverse arch on the transverse side, whereas on the nave side, there are transverse arches. And this is the sort of a lower diaphragm wall above the chancel. I did not write down the name of the master builder. His name is Ramon Yambarts, also from Lombardy. I think Lombardian workshops during that Middle Age was sought after by different bishops and aristocrats. So I go to the last two cathedrals. This is the only one in Portugal, in the town called Coimbra. I think Portuguese pronounce it Coimbra. At about midpoint of that north-south length of the country. But then that was the first capital of Portugal, and the founding king, Afonso Henriques, had the old cathedral of Coimbra built before he ascended to the throne. And he engaged master builders from France. The first one was Robertus, and then he was succeeded by Bernardus, both guys from France. And then what I am impressed with is how elegant. And I think this compares with the best of Romanesque in France itself. And these two master builders, Robertus and Bernardus, they must have come from the long tradition of French builders. the crossing looking into the altar, which was 14th century by Flemish artists. And then when it came to 16th century, they brought a man named Jean de Rouen to do Renaissance chapel. And then we also see the very characteristic ceramic art, which we find in Portugal. Finally, I have four images of Santiago de Compostela. The south transept is the only exterior element left intact in Romanesque. And it was done by Master Esteban. And I show on the right, the long view of the main nave. But then unfortunately, the 19th century chandelier and the Baroque organ seem to impede the long view of impressive Romanesque space. Baroque organ, I think the organ designer did a great job of, you know, when you are in the nave and the look down, and these longer pipes of organ look as though there is a sort of a legion of trumpeters welcoming you. That's amazing. And finally, the exterior of Santiago de Compostela, there is no touch of Romanesque here, because Spain flowered in that particular style called Churrigueresco in 17th century. And this Western facade is 100% Churrigueresco. And even the architect name is identified. But then within that central portal, this is called Porta da Gloria. Inside the narthex is the masterpiece of Santiago by Master Mateo. It's called the Porta da Gloria sculpture. But all the while I went back to Santiago, it was sort of cordoned off because of restoration work. I could not get a shot of that Porta da Gloria. I want to give you a preview. The publisher and I are working on the next book, which will be, I hope, presented in Crown Hall 6 months from now, when we come back to a semi sort of a new normal. So this is what I'm working on now, a view of a Modena Cathedral. Then about a year from now, I hope you will see the book on France. And about 18 months from now, final volume on United Kingdom. For doing United Kingdom, I will be including Gothic masterpieces such as Salisbury Cathedral also, because I thought after looking at Norman alone in UK, something was missing. There are so many important Gothic masterpieces, and not dealing with that at all, that would be such a loss. So 18 months from now, you will be seeing the fifth volume on United Kingdom. So that's the end of my presentation.
Thank you, Professor Kim. Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure.
Just beautiful, for reminding us of the importance of travel at a time when we've not been really allowed to do so. and for providing us with these rich insights into beautiful cultures and rich building types. Thank you so very much. We're looking forward to your next publications. I'd like to introduce Michelangelo Sabatino. Michelangelo is a professor of architectural history and preservation at the College of Architecture. He's the director of the PhD program and the John Vinci Distinguished Research Fellow. He'd like to pose a few questions to Professor Kim. So with that, Michelangelo.
Great. Well, thank you, Cynthia. And of course, thank you, Yongsong, for enriching our understanding and appreciation of Romanesque architecture. So let me jump in then. So in what ways did your training at IIT's College of Architecture help you develop your interest in the material, structural, and spatial qualities of Romanesque architecture? You mentioned Caldwell. Well, how did he deliver these lectures? Just give us a little bit more meat in terms of how you were a young man learning about these things.
Yes, I'm pleased to do it. As a freshman, two semesters of Caldwell's history lecture, I think he must have spent fully half of his lectures on Gothic. We were drilled into Gothic. And so that's how I was inspired to go to on my first visit to Europe to look at all these Gothic cathedrals. But then after I have traveled and then have seen some Romanesque and Gothic, I have already described my great admiration of Amiens nave, but then how disappointed I was about late Gothic, sort of extraneous pinnacles, tabernacles, whatever, creeping into the exterior. So I began to look at Romanesque, not in a systematic way, but then as I traveled, all the while I was walking, I had work-related travels to Europe. So whenever there was 2 days of, stopover, I would make a point of visiting old buildings.
Great.
And I began to appreciate Romanesque. And so it is a acquired taste which formulated over many years.
Right. And did Caldwell show you images in the classes, or did he actually draw the buildings on a chalkboard?
No, he relied on the, old glass lantern or black and white. I suppose they are about, 2.25-inch squares. And of course, all black and white.
Great. So how this brings me to my next question. How is photography different from sketching in terms of a tool students or of architecture can use to learn how to understand buildings? And then do you also sketch when you travel? Or do you prefer just to photograph?
No, I think in my opinion, sketching is more important, especially for students, because photograph, it is a fleeting moment. Once you capture, you may have captured some important elements, but then very often you do not understand how it is put together. Whereas when you are there to sketch, you really have to look how the column is supporting the, arch or, a beam.
Right. And so have you sketched as well?
I did. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So in the foreword of your book, Fritz Neumeier brings attention to the fact that your photos don't have any people in them. So some might see that as a sort of an omission, but can you explain your choice?
Yes. I think having people in a picture is very important to introduce the reference to scale. But then in historical architecture, be it temple in Paestum or a Romanesque or a Gothic cathedral, having one or two people to relate to the scale of interior nave is not all that easy. So you have to almost bring an army of sort of friends who'd stand at a certain spots. And when you are there for two nights, and it's almost impossible. For example, that little image of Basilica of San Isidoro in León, that polylobed arch, that's the shot I wanted. But then when I go there at the morning in the opening hour, there's always one lady offering her prayer. So I had to, you know, go back three or four times. So after doing several different ways, I made a conscious decision to remove people. Sometimes physically remove, but then sometimes the docent or guide in some churches would help me to remove people, to move away from my shot.
So this is the behind the scenes. So let me just end with one last question, because I'm mindful of time, which is also about the whole project of a book. We are living in times when images are widely available on the web. So why do you think it's still important to sort of to present a photo essay in a kind of traditional book format, would you say?
I believe the images available on the internet, by and large, are photographers who do photography for the sake of photographing and for professional gain. And that is why these images, when you put together images from different sources, Pinterest or, you know, Flickr or whatever, they usually become very generic and anonymous. In other words, no person. I got sort of determined to make a rather subjective selection and a collection of pictures for a given work of architecture.
Well, that's a great way, and I hope many will sort of support your efforts by going and buying the book. Thank you, and I now hand it back to Cynthia.
And I will hand it over to Reed. So thank you, Michelangelo. Thank you, Professor. But Reed, all for you.
Just unmuting myself, sorry. I did it so fast, I actually muted myself right back up again, which might be better for the people here. But that was just great. I mean, a wonderful tour through the photography, but more importantly, a wonderful tour through the way that you think and the way that you see, which is the world seen as by an architect. I was just captivated by two things. I have to repeat them. One, the fat man and the thin man, right? That was just great. I was like, wait, there's what? And just that's a whole notion of the transliteration of a person into a building. And then I have to admit, with Michelangelo's question, Michelangelo and I traded a couple of the questions in advance. Michelangelo saying, should I ask him a question about why there aren't any people? And I'm like, yeah, ask that question. And then you saying, well, there were, and we actually had to remove them, which is perfect for an architect. But I just love the idea of you, of the docent sort of shooing these people out for the great photographer who is here gonna record this building. So very nicely done. Anyway, thank you once again. And it's great to know that we'll be back in 6 months. We've kind of got, it sounds like we've got a sort of a 6 month sequence of each of the next books. I'm particularly looking forward to Durham, to England with Durham on the cover, which is some of the most exciting architecture of this period. So thank you once again from all of us for a great talk and for the beautiful, beautiful book.
Great.
Cynthia, back over to you. You're muted.
Thank you. I have one question that came in, and then we have a good friend of Reed's who I think I should allow Reed to introduce.
I'm happy to introduce. Yeah,
a good friend of all of ours. I just wanted to add one question that came in from a student of yours, professor. He happens to live with me, and he asks you refer to the master builder. And so in that period, would that mean the architect? And what is the sort of distinction you make between those who actually build, and was there a difference at that point that you know of?
Yes, I use the master builder instead of architect because I think in fact, during the Middle Ages, the wood itself was non-existent. And whereas master builder was in use. So there was always a workshop, German wood, Bauhütte. And it is led by master builder. And then some of these Bauhütte are engaged for years on end. And then when the bishop and the patron aristocrat run out of their funds, they are let go. And then different workshops are engaged. That is why there are several master builders in a given work of a church. So in that sense, I think for medieval architecture, the word master builder is correct.
Very good. Thank you for that explanation. That's very, very clear now. So I will, without delay, turn this back over to Reed to make introductions to a very special guest here tonight. Oh, and now you're muted, Reed.
My turn. Well, I'm delighted. Thank you, Cynthia. I'm delighted because we have with us tonight an architect who we have with us several architects named Kim here tonight, but one that I've known longer actually is the one who's been around less time, and that's Alice Kim, who is Professor Kim's daughter, who is in partnership in Los Angeles in a practice called JFAK, or John Freeman Alice Kim Architects, which is probably 25 years old now. I don't even want to think of, no. How old is
quite,
the
not
now?
Quite.
It's
21, 20. Yes.
20, okay. Something long like enough that. Though to do very, very substantial buildings all over the valley in Los Angeles, and has received a very significant amount of national attention and international attention as being one of the creative modern practices in Los Angeles. And she may be Jongsun Kim's great masterwork herself. So please help me welcome Alice Kim.
All right, well, thank you, Reed. Thank you, Dad, really, honestly. So I was asked to say a few words at the end of this event, and I'm really happy to do that. It's kind of a unique privilege to be able to say a few things about your father in a context like this. It's not a wedding, it's not a, you know, celebration of a family thing, but it's actually a kind of a celebration really of a professional achievement. So I'm really, really happy to just share with you some thoughts that I have about this very beautiful book that he's produced, both as an architect and also as an artist, because the photography really is the work of a very accomplished artist, I would say. But as Reed, I think, intimated, it's also sort of the result of a very sharp and very human intellect, which is something that I think I certainly really appreciate. So I'm one of three kids, and I think that for me and my brother and sister, one of the really amazing things to witness for the past few years in his producing these books has been not only the rigor, but really the kind of quiet passion that my father has really poured into this chapter of his career. He's not the most demonstrative person. I mean, he's very calm and he's very zen, and everybody loves him because he's very even keeled and you can really talk to him. But he's also very, very passionate. And, you know, the rigor is one thing, and it's the result of his education at IIT and his working for the office of Mies van der Rohe, which is, you know, known for the kind of, you know, the beauty of precision, if you will. And also, you know, of course, he ran a very successful practice in Korea for decades, one that produced large scale housing and museums and hotels and many, many other building types. Although I do think I remember 18 months ago at the launch of his first book, my father pointed out that he has never actually been asked to design a house. So I have a feeling that stage three, after this series of books is done, a house commission is going to find him. And maybe we can make sure that that happens. But it's that passion that I think is actually even more present for me in the books and in the photography and in the last decades of traveling all over Europe to visit and study and photograph all these buildings. And I think one of the great contributions is that he's made visible through his photography the really unstated, if not downright invisible, threads that connect the architecture of the Romanesque with modernism and certainly the work of Mies. I remember, and I think this is something that's always sort of been kind of an underlying fashion for my father. I mean, I remember in parallel, this is not about Romanesque architecture, but as a child going to Seoul, in Seoul, he took us to see this ancient burial shrine in Seoul named Chongmyo. And for those of you who don't know this sort of precinct, it's really austere and it's very beautiful and it's very Miesian. It's this building that it's low slung thing that sits on this plinth, and it's just incredibly powerful. And I remember him saying that, you know, this is my favorite of all the traditional architecture that remains here in Korea and that hasn't been destroyed by the war. Decades later, going to visit it with my husband and partner, John, you know, I was just like, wow, I get it now. This is such a Miesian. I mean, Mies van der Rohe must have seen this place. But so I think that, you know, there's a real relationship between projects like that and also Romanesque architecture with the architecture of Mies and with the architecture of modernism. Now, this past summer during the pandemic, we actually took my parents' oral history, or we started to. And I also really feel that there's a relationship between our father's attraction to work in which space and structural logic and integrity take primacy over ornamentation, and a childhood, his childhood, which was actually relatively hard, full of a lot of hardship and some major tragedy, but also was really punctuated, as he himself told us, by these moments of incredible good fortune and delight, just things that happened by accident that were just so fortuitous and read like things from a movie. And this is a story for another time, but it's really fascinating. And I really do see a direct line between growing up in that manner and the kind of work that he is attracted to and the work he produces, and also kind of the patience with which he pursues it. So I think all of those things are really fascinating, because architecture really is such a discipline of the person. You can't really be an architect unless you really throw your entire body and all your strength and all your everything into it. So, he proved it once again when in his 80s, he dragged my mother all over Europe and got up at, you know, before dawn and, you know, and went to the little spot that he had scouted for 3 hours the day before and set up his camera in the spot that he had chosen and waited for the right second to click that shutter. And architectural photography is such a special discipline, and it takes so much patience, but it's also really, I think, has these incredible rewards. So I guess I would say that I hope that when I'm done with the conventional practice of architecture, which may be soon or it may be a couple decades from now, but I hope that I also have that strength and will and confidence to go out and pursue a different kind of dream, just like my father has. I think the other great contribution is that my father has discovered really another medium through which he can express his reverence for the materiality and the strength of man-made structures. He's not the guy to go out into the forest and go camping. It is really about the man-made structures that, you know, kind of express human aspiration. I know he would never put it this way, but I'm putting it this way for him. But I think that's what drives him. And in sharing, in documenting these incredible works of Romanesque and other periods of architecture and sharing them with the world, I think he's really expanding his legacy to encompass this whole other body of creation that's now opened up to a much broader audience. So I just want to say that I do think this is incredible. I think that, you know, and I and John and Florence, those are my siblings, and Ray and Zoe and Milo and Andy and Ellie and Miranda, we all want to be just like you when we grow up. So thank you very much. And thank you all for hosting this. I'm really happy that we all had a chance to be here with my father to celebrate. And I think now Cynthia and Kristen are going to give us a little tour through the book. So thank you.
Beautiful. Just to give you a little bit of a peek. So again, available at the IIT bookstore. It's in the information is in the chat, and we hope you'll enjoy. Before I turn this back over to Reed and then to Steve Weiss, I just wanted to bring up a question from our very good friend, our chief librarian at the Graham Resource Center, and very dear friend of Professor Kim's and ours. Kim Sass would like you to just touch, Professor, on your actual travel experiences through Spain and Portugal. What was that like?
Is Kim on the screen? No?
She's in the audience.
Oh, in the audience. All right. Okay. Of course, my travels to Spain and Portugal, some locations I visited perhaps four times. And one example, Santiago de Compostela. On one of our visits, the whole town was on strike. And the cathedral itself was closed because of strike. But then I think Spain and Portugal, you know, all of our visits, mostly with my wife, and then I also traveled with a group of my younger associates from my practice, and all of them were so enjoyable. And the, you know, anywhere you go, you cannot go wrong with food. And for example, at the San Salvador de Leyre, I stayed at the monastery, you know, the novices' quarters, which was converted to hotel. And that was a peak of summer. And they served, you have no choice over food, you know. When you stay there, it's a table d'hôte. And then that summer, they served gazpacho of watermelon. Visualize how that tastes. So delicious.
Thank you so much for sharing. Reed, to wrap up the evening and to introduce Steve, would you like to take it from here?
Yep, I'm on my way to get my own watermelon gazpacho any minute now. So that was a good image to mm-hmm. end on. I just want to say thank you to everybody for being here tonight, everybody in our audience and everybody on the panel, but to our special guests, Alice Kim and her father, Jong Sung Kim. Thank you both so much for this evening, especially Professor Kim for sharing your book with us. And I want to welcome everybody who's on the call back to our next event, both in the College of Architecture and in the Mies Society, Mies van der Rohe Society. And with that, I will turn it over to my colleague and friend, Stephen Weiss, who will close us out.
Thank you. Thanks, Reed. And thanks, Jong Sung. And thanks, Alice. That was really wonderful. And very heartfelt. I was a student of Jong Sung's as Cynthia's husband, who's a couple of years older than me. I was in fourth year studio exactly 50 years ago this year. So we've known each other for a very long time. He was a teacher of great honor and great respect and great demand. He was a very demanding professor of architecture, teaching what was the important studio, the studio that converted us from the first 3 years of essentially technical learning of how to be an architect to the last 2 years of really thinking about space and thinking about structure and thinking about architecture. And he was a magnificent, magnificent professor. He also was wildly funny. And while Alice is right, he is a very calm and zen-like man. He had an extraordinary sense of humor. And fat man, thin man in Romanesque architecture couldn't be a better description of that. But the most important thing I'll say, Alice said that she and her siblings and all of their children to grow up to be like Jong Sung. Many of the people that were his students that learned architecture from him stayed as architects. As we all know, many people get out of architecture school and head to the nearest developer or construction company, with all due respect, Ed, and do other things. But many stay to practice architecture. And in my case, and that of other of colleagues, friends of mine whom I've talked about this to, Jong Sung Kim is the reason we stayed to be architects, because he thought about architecture and practiced it in a way that made us feel like we could make the world better from his learning. And that's all my career has been about, and I know Keith's and many others. And so thank you, particularly Jong Sung, for sharing this late career change and helping move the college continuously, move the college forward. Thank you all to joining us tonight. The Mies Society is delighted to be in partnership with the College of Architecture and producing great programs such as this. We are in the process of preparing for next year, and we're in the process, for those of you that might not be members of the Mies Society, we're in the process of wrapping up a fundraising effort to restore the South Porch travertine of Crown Hall. And if you join the Mies Society, your membership and any contribution you make goes towards that effort. And so please think about us in that way. And thank you all. And Cynthia, once again, Thank you. Wonderful show.
Thank you, everyone. And it's easy when you have such great material and great people to work with. So again, Professor Kim, and to all the panelists who took time tonight to be with us, and speakers, and to all of you for supporting the Mises Society out in the audience. Thank you, you're our friends. And thank you and have a great evening.